Hello all. So let's discuss certain important topics of GIT. Let's see the drugs which we have for the treatment of gallstones or dissolving gallstones, drugs for treatment of short bowel syndrome, various pancreatic enzymes, and the treatment of inflammatory bowel conditions. Okay, so let's see first the drugs for gallstones, dissolving gallstones. Okay, so we'll make a heading, drugs for dissolving gallstones. The drugs we have for dissolving gallstones are, you'll write, first we have is bile acids. Okay, among bile acids we will discuss, we have three bile acids mainly. One is quinol, deoxycholic acid, we have ursodeoxycholic acid, and lastly a new drug, that is obeticholic acid. Obeticholic acid. Now remember, the next class of drug which is given for dissolving gallstones are known as hypolipidemic drugs. Hypolipidemic drugs, they will decrease the level of cholesterol in the bile. Hence, they will also help in dissolving gallstones. So nowadays, we very commonly use statins. Okay, statins. We'll also write ezetimibe. Ezetimibe reduces the absorption of statin. So what statin does? Statin inhibits HMG-CoA reductase enzyme in the liver. It inhibits HMG-CoA reductase enzyme in the liver, and it inhibits synthesis of cholesterol in the liver, because this is the rate limiting step of cholesterol synthesis. Ezetimibe inhibits the absorption of cholesterol from our GIT into the liver. So it is a cholesterol, it inhibits cholesterol absorption. It inhibits cholesterol absorption. We can also use resins or fibrates. Fibrates are PPAR gamma agonist. PPAR alpha agonist. They also reduce the production of triglyceride as well as cholesterol. So for the more details of hypolipidemics, please refer to the videos of hypolipidemics. Okay, please refer to the videos of hypolipidemics. So let's start with bile acid that are used for dissolving the gallstones. So let's see what are the drugs. The first drug we have is quinol deoxycholic acid. Now this is also known as quinodiol. Okay, then we have ursodeoxycholic acid. It is also known as ursodiol. Okay, now let's see what is the difference between these bile acids we have. Remember, this quinodeoxycholic acid, what is the main mechanism of action? It generally inhibit synthesis of cholesterol in liver. While if we talk about ursodeoxycholic acid, it inhibits intestinal absorption of cholesterol back to the liver. Intestinal absorption of cholesterol. Okay. Now the point is, if this cholesterol synthesis doesn't occur in the liver, what happens? It leads to increase in LDL level. It increases LDL level in the blood, LDL-C. LDL-C means LDL cholesterol level in the blood. Why? Because of reduction of this liver, it will stop taking LDL from the blood. And the blood LDL level will increase. So it increases blood LDL level, which is a bad thing. What about ursodeoxycholic acid? Ursodeoxycholic acid decreases LDL level in the blood. LDL, which is a bad lipid, and it is a good thing for a patient. so it will decrease blood cholesterol level or LDL level. Okay, now the action of quinodeoxycholic acid is a very slow action. It takes very long time, slow action, and it has a very fast onset of action in dissolving gallstone. Okay, so again it's a good thing. Next point is, you'll write where it is used. Because of this reason, this ursodeoxycholic acid, it has now become the drug of choice for the treatment and prevention for gallstones. If there is gallstones, for treatment and prevention, the drug of choice is ursodeoxycholic acid. Okay, it is also the drug of choice, ursodeoxycholic acid, for primary, biliary cirrhosis. Because in primary biliary cirrhosis, there is also excessive, the liver bile ducts are not properly formed. So in primary biliary cirrhosis, we give two drugs. One is ursodeoxycholic acid plus we give a corticosteroid. Corticosteroid will prevent this malformation. That corticosteroid is budesonide. This is the treatment of primary biliary cirrhosis. Okay. Now, where this quinodeoxycholic acid is used? Quinodeoxycholic acid is used only in resistant cases or refractory cases, especially in cases of radiolucent stone. Especially in cases of radiolucent stones, we give quinodeoxycholic acid. Now we have a third bile acid, that is obeticholic acid. Obeticholic acid, it is given in the treatment of primary biliary cholangitis. Okay, it is given in the treatment of primary biliary cholangitis. So these are the three bile acids. There are three bile acids which are responsible for treatment of various biliary disease, especially gallstones. Okay, now let's talk about the next disease, that is short bowel syndrome. Okay, let's talk about now second disease, that is short bowel syndrome. Okay, now what is short bowel syndrome? Short bowel syndrome is a disease in which there is malabsorption. There is cases of malabsorption due to small length of intestine. The length of the intestine is small. Because of this reason, the food is not able to absorb properly. Now why it could happen? Either it could happen due to surgical removal of intestine, or if there is some congenital malformation. Congenital defect or congenital malformation, the length of intestine is already very low. So what is the treatment? So the patient will have malabsorption and the patient will have diarrheas. Okay, let's see what is the treatment. The first treatment is, we have to maintain nutrition. But if we will give something orally, the thing will not absorb properly. Hence the mainstay of treatment is, total parenteral nutrition. Okay, total parenteral nutrition. This is the main thing. Okay, that is the mainstay of treatment of short bowel syndrome. Second point, we should increase the growth of intestinal mucosa. Because if we will increase the growth of intestinal mucosa, there will be better absorption of the food. So there are two drugs which can be given. The first drug is teduglutide. What is teduglutide? Teduglutide is a recombinant GLP-2 hormone analog. Okay, it is a type of incretin. GLP-2 stands for glucagon like peptide. Now, this glucagon like peptide, remember, it is normally synthesized in our intestine also by ileum. The function of this GLP2 enzyme is to increase the secretion of insulin like growth factor. And insulin like growth factor increases mucosal growth. It causes increase in mucosal growth. Okay. So, teduglutide increases mucosal growth. We can use also one more drug, that is somatropin. Somatropin. What is somatropin? Somatropin is recombinant growth hormone. And remember, recombinant growth hormone also increases the release of insulin-like growth factor. Insulin-like growth factor will cause mucosal growth. So these are the two drugs which have been approved for increasing the mucosal growth in short bowel syndrome. Okay, so one is recombinant GLP-2 analog. Second is recombinant growth hormone analog. Now remember, these two drugs are absolutely contraindicated in cancer patient. Why? Because they have potential to cause cancers, colon cancers. Now the third treatment we have to give, we have to reduce the HCl secretion or gastric secretions, because increase in gastric secretion can lead to diarrheas. For this, the drug of choice is proton pump inhibitors, PPI. Proton pump inhibitors, you can also give H2 blockers. So please refer to the videos of acid peptic disease or proton pump inhibitors. And lastly, we have to decrease diarrhea also or other GIT secretion. For this, we can give opioids like loperamide. So these are the drugs we have for treatment of short bowel syndrome. The mainstay is total parenteral nutrition. Teduglutide is a very new drug and it's a very important drug for you. Growth hormone was traditionally also used, but both have same mechanism of action. Okay. Now let's talk about pancreatic enzyme replacement. The disease is pancreatic enzymes. Now, why we need to give pancreatic enzyme in which disease? They are given, where they are indicated. They are indicated in cases of chronic pancreatitis, because in chronic pancreatitis, the pancreas become damaged. It is also seen in cases of cystic fibrosis. Chronic pancreatitis is seen in cases of cystic fibrosis, because in cystic fibrosis, there is chronic pancreatitis. Hence, you know that pancreas secretes various enzymes like lipase. It secretes other enzymes also. Because of no enzyme secretion, it can lead to a symptom. That symptom is known as steatorrhea. Chronic pancreatitis, the patient will present to you with steatorrhea or malabsorption. Okay. So in cystic fibrosis patient, the patient suffers from chronic pancreatitis. The patient suffers from steatorrhea. But remember, in cystic fibrosis, the patient also suffers from recurrent pneumonias also. Recurrent pneumonia, because there is lungs damage also. So let's see, if there is chronic pancreatitis, how to treat this? So we give lipase. That lipase is given for the treatment of steatorrhea. Okay, because fat malabsorption will occur, fat will not dissolve. That enzyme is known as pancrelipase. So this is the drug which has been approved. We also give trypsin enzyme. Now remember, trypsin is not given for steatorrhea. Trypsin is given to treat pain of chronic pancreatitis. Trypsin is given for pain relief in chronic pancreatitis. So we give trypsin enzymes from outside and lipase enzyme from outside. Okay. The next class of drug, we will write one miscellaneous drug, that is anti-flatulence drug. Anti-flatulence drug, what they will do, they will burst bubbles. Okay, they will burst bubbles. So where they are used? They are given for the treatment of flatulence, which is in common word known as flatulence, which is in common word known as gas. Okay, There are two drugs which are there. The first drug is simethicone, and the second drug is methyl poly siloxane. So these are the two drugs which are approved as an anti-flatulence drug. Okay, anti-flatulence drug. Okay, now let's see the treatment of inflammatory bowel disease. Hello all. So let's discuss about the treatment of inflammatory bowel disease. Now, inflammatory bowel disease is of two types. Okay, the first one is known as Crohn's disease. Okay, and the second one is known as ulcerative colitis. Second one is known as ulcerative colitis. So there is a difference between the pathogenesis and the presentation of both. Remember, in ulcerative colitis, the lesions in the intestine are contiguous lesions. Okay, contiguous lesion. So continuous ulcers are seen, and it can involve any part of the GIT. It can involve any part of the GIT, but it is most commonly seen in the rectal area. Rectum and sigmoid, distal colon, it is more commonly seen. While in Crohn's disease, the lesions, remember, they are skip lesions. The ulcer will occur in between. So there are skip lesions. And most common involvement of Crohn's disease is from ileocecal junction. Okay. It starts from ileocecal junction, and it can generally ascend or descend towards any side. Okay, now both are inflammatory bowel disease, and what is the exact cause, we don't know. But let's see what are the drugs we use. The drugs we give in the treatment of inflammatory bowel disease are immunosuppressive drug. We have to suppress inflammation. Immunosuppressives. And nowadays there is a potential role of antibiotics or antimicrobial also. Okay, antibiotics or antimicrobial. So let's talk about first immunosuppressive drug for the treatment of Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Okay, so let's talk about first about the treatment of Crohn's disease. The treatment of Crohn's disease. Now, if a patient of Crohn's disease comes to you with acute attack, if the patient comes to you with acute attack of Crohn's disease, what we have to do? We have to give an induction therapy. We have to give an induction therapy to produce remission so that the symptoms will subside. Okay, to produce remission. Then we have to give a maintenance therapy. Why we need to give maintenance therapy? So that there should be no recurrence of symptoms. Okay, no recurrence of symptoms. Now, what is the drug of choice for the treatment of induction therapy? The drug of choice for induction is corticosteroids. The drug of choice is corticosteroids. Okay, so corticosteroids are considered as a drug of choice for the treatment of induction. Now, which corticosteroid, if it is a mild disease, if it is a mild disease, remember, we give oral budesonide, and it is generally considered as a drug of choice among steroid. Oral budesonide is considered as a drug of choice. The reason is budesonide gets very less absorbed into the blood. Hence, the systemic effect of corticosteroid which is seen is very less. But if it is moderate to severe variety, moderate to severe variety, we can switch over to oral prednisolone. Oral prednisolone. If it is still more severe, we can give intravenous methylprednisolone. Okay, intravenous methylprednisolone, which is better than intravenous hydrocortisone, because hydrocortisone causes salt water retention, which can lead to hypertension. Hydrocortisone. Okay, so traditionally the drug of choice is oral budesonide. Now what happens if we will try to stop now steroid, because steroids are generally given for 1 to 2 months and then we gradually taper off the dose of steroid. Okay, we gradually taper off the dose of steroids. Now what happens if the when we taper off the dose of steroid, then if this disease again comes back, it is known as steroid dependent Crohn's disease. Steroid dependent disease, that when we decrease the dose of steroid, again there is induction, again there is attack of. Or second cause could be there is steroid resistance. There is steroid resistance. Now steroid resistance means you have started corticosteroid and still there is no response. This is known as steroid resistant cases. Now remember, the drug of choice for steroid dependent cases is azathioprine. Okay, and its active form can also be used. It's an active form of 6-mercaptopurine, but we prefer to give azathioprine. In steroid resistant cases, the drug of choice is intravenous cyclosporin. Okay, the drug of choice is intravenous cyclosporin. Okay, in cyclosporin, if there is response to cyclosporin, then change over to azathioprine. If the response is positive, change over to azathioprine. But if there is cyclosporin resistant also, then change over to the next drug, that is tacrolimus. So cyclosporin and tacrolimus are calcineurin derivatives, the inhibitors. They are immunosuppressive drugs. So the drug of choice for steroid resistant cases is intravenous cyclosporin, while the drug of choice for steroid dependent cases is azathioprine. Okay, now the point is, if there is still no response, then as a last resort we have to start anti-TNF-alpha monoclonal antibody. Anti-TNF-alpha monoclonal antibody. So the drugs are infliximab, certolizumab, and adalimumab. They are also used in rheumatoid arthritis. Adalimumab. Okay. Now there is a role of a drug which is effective in both cases. That drug which is effective in both cases, but it is not the drug of choice, that drug is methotrexate. Methotrexate can be given in both cases of steroid dependent and steroid resistant cases of Crohn's disease. Okay, so if a patient cannot tolerate azathioprine or cyclosporin, we can start methotrexate. In steroid dependent cases we can give orally. In resistant cases of corticosteroid we can give IV. So methotrexate can be given by both route. Okay, now let's talk about maintenance. If you talk about maintenance, the treatment of maintenance is the treatment of maintenance of Crohn's disease is, we don't prefer to give corticosteroid for maintenance because in long term it can lead to Cushing syndrome. Hence the drug of choice for maintenance is generally azathioprine. The drug of choice for maintenance is azathioprine. If there is no response to azathioprine, we start with anti-TNF-alpha drugs. We start with anti-TNF-alpha drugs, same drugs which were used in induction also, infliximab, certolizumab, and adalimumab. If there is still no response, we will add a drug that is anti इंटेग्रिन मोनोक्लोनल एंटीबॉडी MAB. सो द ड्रग्स आर विच इज यूज दैट इज विडोलीजुमैब. अर्लियर वी यूज अ ड्रग नटालीजुमैब, नाउ वी डोंट प्रेफर टू गिव नटालीजुमैब बिकॉज नटालीजुमैब कैन एंटर इन टू ब्रेन एंड इट कैन कॉज अ वायरल इन्फेक्शन नोन एज JC पॉलियोमा वायरस इन्फेक्शन. बिकॉज ऑफ सप्रेशन ऑफ इम्यूनिटी इट कैन कॉज JC पॉलियोमा वायरस इन्फेक्शन इन द ब्रेन. हेंस वी गिव विडोलीजुमैब बिकॉज विडोलीजुमैब डज नॉट क्रॉस ब्लड ब्रेन बैरियर. सो दिस इज द इम्यूनोसप्रेसिव ड्रग्स विच वी गिव इन द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ क्रॉन्स डिजीज. ओके, नाउ देर इज अ रोल ऑफ एंटी माइक्रोबियल ड्रग्स ऑल्सो बिकॉज इट इज नॉट प्रूवन दैट इन क्रॉन्स डिजीज एंड अल्सरेटिव कोलाइटिस देर इज डिसबायोसिस. डिसबायोसिस मीन्स दैट देर इज ग्रोथ ऑफ हार्मफुल बैक्टीरिया. सो देर इज ग्रोथ ऑफ हार्मफुल बैक्टीरिया which causes inflammatory harmful bacteria which can lead to inflammatory bowel disease. Hence we give antimicrobial and it is mainstay of treatment especially in cases of pediatric IBS. If this irritable bowel syndrome is occurring, sorry, inflammatory bowel disease is occurring in small children, then antimicrobial must be given. Now, which antimicrobial is generally preferred? The drug of choice we start with is ciprofloxacin in a combination with metronidazole. Okay, you can also give amoxicillin clavulinic acid, or you can also give piperacillin and tazobactam. Can give piperacillin and tazobactam, and you can also give rifaximin. So this is the order of preference of giving antimicrobial. Okay, now let's talk about the treatment of ulcerative colitis. Okay, but before starting ulcerative colitis, remember there is a new option which is right now not approved. We can replace the good bacterias as well. We can replace good bacterias as well in our intestine, that is known as fecal microbiota transplant. We can directly give good bacterias, transplant them into intestine. Okay, or we can give this good bacterias orally in a sachet in a live form known as probiotics. Okay, probiotics. So this is the treatment of inflammatory bowel disease, that is Crohn's disease. Let's see the treatment of ulcerative colitis. Okay. Let's see the treatment of ulcerative colitis. The treatment of ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease is very similar, just we will add one new drug in it. Okay, so we will write again for induction and for maintenance. Okay, in induction, let's see if a patient is having mild symptoms, the drug of choice is 5-ASA compounds. Okay, so these drugs are mesalamine, sulfasalazine, olsalazine and balsalazide. Okay, so they are also immunosuppressive drug, balsalazide. So we will discuss these drugs shortly in a great detail. Okay, this is the most important drug. Now remember, if there is no response, that means no response or resistant cases, or if it is moderate to severe variety, if it is moderate to severe variety, then the drug of choice is corticosteroid. Now you have to remember, if both options will come, corticosteroids are considered as an overall drug of choice. Okay, and they are also the overall drug of choice for induction. okay, and they are also the drug of choice for acute attack. It is also the drug of choice for acute attack. And same steroid we generally use, we can use oral budesonide. Okay, or you can give rectal, because ulcerative colitis occurs in distal colon. Most commonly we can give rectal enemas of steroids, like all steroids rectal enema can be given, like rectal enema of hydrocortisone. If there is no response, then we can give oral prednisolone. If still there is no response, we can transfer to intravenous methylprednisolone or intravenous hydrocortisone in severe cases. Okay, if there is still no response. Now the same treatment goes again, like just like Crohn's disease, in steroid dependent cases we give azathioprine, and in steroid resistant cases we give IV cyclosporin. And in cyclosporin resistant cases we can give tacrolimus. Now remember, in ulcerative colitis there is no role of methotrexate. So methotrexate was only used in Crohn's disease. Okay, there is no role of methotrexate in ulcerative colitis. Hence, now in even resistant cases, still not responsive, we will start with anti-TNF-alpha monoclonal antibody, which we have already written, infliximab, sertolizumab, etc., which we have already written. Okay, now let's talk about the treatment of maintenance. The drug of choice for maintenance again is 5-ASA compounds. So 5-ASA compounds can be given for acute induction and for maintenance also. Now if not responsive cases, remember corticosteroids are not given, because corticosteroid in long term causes Cushing syndrome. Here we will start with azathioprine. Still not responsive, we will start with anti-TNF-alpha drugs. Still not responsive, we can start with anti-integrin monoclonal antibody. Okay, so the treatment is absolutely same, just we have added 5-ASA compounds. Okay, so before starting with 5-ASA compounds, just write certain new drugs for ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. So we will write a drug, ustekinumab is a new drug which is a monoclonal antibody. It's a monoclonal antibody that blocks interleukin 1-2 and interleukin 2-3. Okay, and it is given for the treatment of Crohn's disease. Okay, Crohn's disease. Then we have tofacitinib. Tofacitinib is a JAK inhibitor or Janus kinase inhibitor. It inhibits Janus 1 and 3 kinase, and it has been approved for the treatment of ulcerative colitis. Okay, it has been approved for the treatment of ulcerative colitis. So let's talk about one great drug in great detail, that is 5-ASA compounds. Okay, now what is 5-ASA? 5-ASA stands for 5-aminosalicylic acid. Okay, this 5-aminosalicylic acid, remember, is an immunosuppressive molecule. Hence, it reduces the immunity in Crohn's disease. So, sorry, ulcerative colitis. Remember, they are only given in ulcerative colitis. and only in cases of distal ulcerative colitis when it is occurring in colon. When it is occurring in colon, okay? So let's talk about these compounds. The first drug we have among them is sulfasalazine. Okay? Now sulfasalazine has a property. When sulfasalazine is given orally, it goes to colon. And in colon, there are bacteria. Okay? This bacteria breaks down this sulfasalazine into two molecules. Okay? So can we say that sulfasalazine is a prodrug? It has two active forms. The first form is 5-ASA, that is 5-aminosalicylic acid. Okay? So it will liberate 5-aminosalicylic acid. And it is bound to a drug known as sulfapyridine. Sulfapyridine. Sulfapyridine, remember, is a type of sulfonamide. It is a type of sulfonamide. Now, normally in sulfasalazine, they are attached by a bond known as azo bond. And this bacteria, remember, it breaks down this azo bond. It breaks azo bond. Okay? So, this bond between them is broken down by sulfasalazine, and that is by bacteria. Now what happens after this has liberated 5-ASA? 5-ASA will remain here, and sulfapyridine, it comes into the blood. Remember, sulfapyridine is used for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. When it comes into the blood, it also acts as an immunosuppressant, while 5-ASA is used for the treatment of ulcerative colitis. So this one drug has two uses. Okay? So this one drug has two uses. Now let's see what are the side effects of sulfasalazine. We know the side effect of sulfasalazine comes due to this sulfapyridine or sulfonamide. So it causes sulfa allergy. It causes sulfa allergy. Okay. Now why sulfa allergy? Because it's a kind of sulfonamide. Second, it also decreases sperm count. It reduces sperm count. And lastly, it causes bone marrow suppression. It causes bone marrow suppression. So can we say this moiety of sulfapyridine, which is effective in rheumatoid arthritis, is producing lot of side effect that is not required in ulcerative colitis. Hence, we have made now new drugs. Okay. Hence, we have made now new drugs. So let's see what are the new other drugs which we have made. The first drug is olsalazine. Olsalazine contains two molecules of 5-ASA, aminosalicylic acid. It does not contain sulfapyridine, and by a bond known as azo bond. This bond is broken down by the bacteria, and both molecules of 5-ASA, both molecules of 5-ASA will remain in the colon, and they will produce effect in ulcerative colitis. Okay. Similarly, we have balsalazide. Balsalazide contains 5-ASA and 5-ABA. Again, by a bond, azo bond. ABA stands for amino benzoyl alanine. Again, this moiety is inactive moiety. And the last drug we have, the best one, which is now considered as a drug of choice among them, that is mesalazine. Okay. Remember, mesalazine is also known as mesalamine. Okay. And mesalamine contains only 5-ASA. It contains only 5-ASA. But remember how it is given. There is a drawback of mesalamine. The mesalamine drawback is mesalamine gets absorbed from stomach and small intestine. So before it can reach into colon, it cannot reach into the colon. It gets absorbed proximally. Because of this reason, we have made pH or time release tablet of mesalamine. So it will release mesalamine only in colon. Okay, or we have made delayed release tablet of mesalamine, which will release mesalamine only in colon. Okay, because mesalamine get absorbed proximally from colon. Before the large intestine, it can absorb from stomach or small intestine. It can liberate out air. But we want that 5-ASA should get liberated only in colon. Hence, we made pH and time release tablets of mesalamine. Okay. So, 5-ASA is the active moiety, 5-aminosalicylic acid, which produces immunosuppressive effect in cases of ulcerative colitis. So, these are the drugs which we give for the treatment of ulcerative colitis. And this completes our inflammatory bowel disease. So, thank you very much.